But we're carrying on in look at the parables. We're looking at the parables I've grouped under the heading or the label, the consummation of the kingdom. As I've mentioned, some of these things you could put in more than one category, and sometimes you may think, well, this better belongs in another category, and that's all right. I could say a little bit more about the talents and the minas, but I'm not. I'm going to move on and look at the parable of the sheep and the goats, which occurs only in Matthew 25, verses 31 to 46. Now, it's not a parable proper, but it's a two-verse analogy to the separation that will take place at the final judgment. Verses 32 and 33, you get this two-verse analogy to the separation that is going to take place at the final judgment. And the analogy is incorporated into the description of the judgment at Christ's return. And the separation is depicted by the analogy. And then the following verses you get in verses 34 through 46, they explain the reason for and the significance of the separation. So let's read this, Matthew 25, 31 to 46. When the Son of Man comes in His glory and all the angels with Him, then He will sit on His glorious throne. Before Him will be gathered all the nations, and He will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And He will place the sheep on His right, but the goats on the left. Then the King will say to those on His right, come, you are blessed by My Father. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer Him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? Or thirsty and give you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the King will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it to the least of these My brothers, you did it to Me. Then He will say to those on His left, depart from Me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave Me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave Me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome Me. Naked, and you did not clothe Me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit Me. Then they also will answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister to you? Then He will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to Me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Now, when Jesus returns to consummate the kingdom He inaugurated with His first coming, all the nations, meaning all the people of all the nations, will be separated into two groups, the sheep and the goats. And as David Turner notes, he said, this passage evidently assumes rather than mentions a resurrection. And then he cites a number of texts dealing with the judgment and dealing with the resurrection. Now, mixed flocks were common in that world. I don't know if they're still common today, but they were common because it was more economical to work with only one herd, and because the more restless goats, they would keep the flock on the move, thereby producing more effective grazing in sparsely vegetated areas. So you wanted to have them keep moving, and the goats functioned that way because they were more restless. But at various times, it was no doubt necessary to separate the two, to separate the sheep from the goats. Now, sheep are a regular Old Testament image for the people of God. You see that in a number of places, Psalm 74:1, 78:52, 79:12 and 13, and a number of other texts. But goats are not. See, sheep are a regular Old Testament image for God's people, but sheep are not. So it's not surprising in the story here that the sheep are put on the Lord's right and the goats are put on His left. Because in Jewish culture, as in some other cultures, right and left frequently symbolize favor and disfavor. Not all the time, but frequently right and left symbolize favor and disfavor. So the sheep, being an Old Testament image of the people of God, it's not surprising, they're on the right. The goats are put on the left. Now the one group that you have here, the sheep, on the right, they're blessed by the Father in that they now take their inheritance. You see, they take their inheritance, the kingdom prepared for them from the foundation of the world. This is where we're headed. You see, this consummated kingdom. Now, you note that the term inheritance, it presupposes a relationship with the Father. You see, that's who heirs are. Heirs are those who are connected to the Father, descendants of the Father. And you can see that, for example, in Romans chapter 8, verse 15 and 17, that connection, that presupposing a relationship with the Father is an inherent part of being an heir. Now, this will help us when we look at the basis of the judgment. They are to receive or inherit a place in the consummated kingdom. So here they will enter into that inheritance that's been prepared for them from the foundation of the world. That is this realm that is in total harmony with God's perfect will. This realm where all things are functioning according to the eternal vision of God. And verse 46 specifies that life in this perfect realm, it will be eternal. And you see that in a number of places. For example, you see it in Revelation 21, 1-4. This glorious inheritance that is prepared for the sheep was the Father's plan for them from the beginning. That's why when you look at Scripture, you see this unfolding, and this is where it goes. This is what's going on. Now, the other group, I'll skip to the third slide here. The other group, the goats on the left, are cursed. They're cursed, and they're sent into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. So you've got one group that inherits this wonderful blessing from the foundation of the world, this other group that is cursed and put in the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. And verse 46 refers to this state as eternal punishment. Now, as I've said a number of times here, whatever we do with the imagery of hell, you cannot drain it so that it is not the ultimate bummer, the ultimate horror, the thing that no sane person would ever want to experience. You see this in all of the pictures, shut out, fire, all of these things. So we can never drain it of that. Now, the deciding factor in who went where is that at the first level, it's quite obvious. It's apparent. The deciding factor is those who had compassion and mercy on the least of these, my brothers of the Lord, the least of these brothers of the Lord, they inherit the kingdom, and those who did not are punished eternally in the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Now, this certainly does not mean, it certainly does not mean that the compassionate and merciful person who does not believe in Jesus will be saved. It does not mean that. It cannot mean that. The entire New Testament is perfectly clear that salvation is by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. It is not on the basis of our response to human need. So you sometimes have people saying, well, you see, this is all. No. You see, that would overturn all of the New Testament. It's certainly not that. So the real question is how the listed acts of compassion and mercy, how they relate to faith in Christ. Because it's absolutely clear that salvation is by grace through faith in Christ. So the question is, how do these acts of mercy that he speaks of here, how are they related to faith in Christ? And the answer to that depends to an extent on how one understands the least of these, my brothers. The least of these, my brothers. What does that mean? Because he says, the one who has compassion and mercy on the least of these, my brothers. Well, we're looking at how is that related to faith in Christ? And one of the keys is, well, what does that mean? Now, many understand this phrase, the least of these, my brothers. Many take that to refer to all those who are hungry. All who are distressed. All who are needy. And in this view, Jesus is saying, look, if we don't love those in need, whoever they are, then our claim to have faith is false. Now, there's something to be said for that, and I'll say it in a minute. But the weakness of this view is that there's no other place in which the term brothers of Jesus refers to people or men in general. Matthew 12, 48 to 50, Matthew 23, 8, Matthew 28, 10, they all use that term for disciples. You see, this idea of my brothers, brothers of Jesus, well, his brothers are referred to in Matthew as his disciples. And in addition, when he says the least of these, that word least, it is a superlative form of the word little. And little ones, that phrase little ones in Matthew always refers to disciples. So brothers refers to disciples, little ones refers to disciples. And so this least of these, my brothers, it certainly looks like he's referring to Christians. And in fact, many scholars, recent scholars, because of that, they argue in line with, by the way, the most common understanding of scholars throughout church history, that Jesus is specifically identifying himself with his disciples. He's identifying and hooking with them. This group of modern scholars, I'm sure it's much broader, but this group of modern scholars who recognize that Jesus is here identifying with disciples includes D.A. Carson and Donald Hagner and Craig Blomberg and Leon Morris and Craig Keener and David Turner. And so the point then becomes, well, how does mercy and compassion toward Jesus' disciples, how's that an indication, you see? What's the relation there? If mercy and compassion toward Jesus' disciples, that then is an indication of what? That these people have accepted the gospel and they stand with Christ. You see, that's the idea. They have joined the revolution, and therefore they identify specially with the revolution's participants. So yes, we are here, and what? You have mercy and compassion on Christians. What does that say about your faith in Christ? It says that I have faith in Christ because I identify with them, because we are all participants in the revolution. They are my brothers. And so I specifically have concern for them. And I think that's what he's talking about here, you see. Matthew 10, 40 to 42, you see a parallel idea. Whoever receives you, talking about those he sent, receives me. You see, he's tied up with them. You see the same kind of idea in Acts 9, 4 and 5 and Acts 22, 7 and 8, where Jesus so identifies with disciples that he says that persecuting his disciples is persecuting him. Remember, he says to him, why are you persecuting me? He says, what are you talking about? Well, he's on his way to persecute disciples. To persecute disciples is to persecute Christ. You see, there's this connection that he has. Now, of course, biblical saving faith produces mercy and compassion for the poor and oppressed generally. I wouldn't deny that. I wouldn't argue about that. Of course it would. Saving faith would produce mercy and compassion for the poor and the oppressed generally. Matthew 23, 39, love your neighbor as yourself. Galatians 2:10, remember the poor. You see, so it would produce that. And it would produce good deeds toward all people. Galatians chapter 6, verse 10. You see, so it would, in fact, do that. But see, since Christians are to be especially concerned about the household of faith, right? Do good to all people, especially. Especially. The household of faith, the household of believers, especially to fellow Christians. And since that's the case, you see, acts of mercy and kindness toward fellow Christians, they're a kind of first order fruit of faith. You see, I wouldn't deny that a person who has saving faith will be compassionate on the poor and the needy and the oppressed generally. But having that kind of compassion and mercy toward brothers and sisters in Christ is a kind of first order fruit of faith. However else one's faith will manifest itself. however else that will take place, of faith that is callous to the needs and the sufferings of the king's brothers is not saving faith. You see? However, that's like, look, you cannot be callous to the needs and the sufferings of the Lord's brothers, your brothers. If that's the case, then the faith isn't saving. You see, now, in this light, by the way, those in prison refers to Christians who are imprisoned for their faith, as occurred throughout the book of Acts and the rest of the New Testament. That's where the focus is. He's talking about that. You see, so it's not just generally speaking about prisoners as though that's somehow a special category, that oppression and need, that kind of thing. I have no problem with visiting prisoners and that kind of thing. I just think to take it from this text that that's what he's talking about. He's speaking, as I read it, of those who are imprisoned for their faith. And so it is this compassion and mercy that is exhibited toward disciples. Now, the surprise of both of these groups at the judgment is not over the place they are, where they are. That's not the surprise. It's not over where they're assigned, but over the statement that they had treated or failed to treat Jesus a certain way. That's where the surprise is. In the portrayal, see, neither group realizes that Jesus identifies with the least of his disciples to such an extent that what is done or not done for them is done or not done for him. Just like in the persecution. Why are you persecuting me? Well, I'm not. I'm persecuting these people. They're my brothers. And in persecuting them, you're persecuting me. In failing to do for disciples, you're failing to do for me. You see, and that's their thing, is that when did this happen? Now, the lack of realization, I'm going to kind of go off on something that may not interest you here, but let me give it to you, then we'll go on. All right, the lack of realization on the part of the righteous is curious to me in light of the fact that Jesus is here. He's here making clear that's what is done for the least of the brothers is done for him. You see, given this teaching, how can they not understand when he says on judgment day, when he says that they gave him something to eat, something to drink, etc., in light of this teaching that we're looking at, how can they not understand that he's referring to their acts of kindness toward his brothers? Well, what's up with that? All right, now some think that supports the idea that, well, least of these my brothers or these brothers of mine, that it doesn't refer to disciples. And the thinking in that regard is that, look, the righteous were unaware that Jesus identified with the people they served. The reason they were unaware of that is because these people were not disciples. So they didn't understand that Jesus identified with them. But you see, to me, that doesn't answer the question. That simply relocates the problem. Because if Jesus is here teaching that he identifies with needy people in general, then how can the righteous not know at the judgment that they served Jesus in serving needy non-disciples? He's teaching about it here. So on judgment, why are they surprised? You see, why are they surprised? Now, others think this supports the idea that Christians served other Christians without any conscious thought of Jesus' identification with them. In other words, that's the way they go at it. Say, well, no, I think what it is it's saying that they served disciples, fellow Christians, without any conscious thought that Jesus identified with them. And so they were doing that from a motive that was untainted by any calculation of self-benefit. But if being aware that Jesus identifies with the least of his brothers, if that risks tainting a person's service of them with a motive of self-benefit, then why did Jesus so clearly teach that he identifies with them? You see, if that runs the risk that by doing that, you're going to taint the service, well, then why did he do that? You see, he seems to be teaching about the identification precisely to encourage brotherly kindness and mercy toward disciples. That's why he's doing it. He's saying, I'm them. I identify with them to such an extent that what you do for them, you do for me. So you need to be doing it for them. You see, he seems to be doing it specifically to encourage those kinds of acts of mercy and kindness. See, so that makes it difficult for me to believe that the acts done from an awareness of Christ identifying with his brothers, that somehow that service is invalid or is less noble. I don't think there's anything that's not noble about serving somebody in an awareness that they are, in fact, Jesus identifies with them. I think that's why he's telling us to do that, to encourage us and strengthen us in doing that. Okay, what do I think's going on? My guess is that the answering righteous in verse 37, that it refers to only some of the righteous. And they are called out and they are made to speak for the righteous because this would be a group that did not know that Jesus was so identified with the people. Certainly there are going to be some Christians on that day. See, who are not aware on that judgment, who are not aware that Jesus identifies with Christians, or that he identifies with them to such an extent that what is done for them is done. There will be some. You see, there will be some who are either illiterate, you know, I mean, throughout history, they're going to be Christians. And what I think Jesus is doing, I think he highlights them as the spokesman of the righteous in this symbolic portrayal of the judgment, because their lack of awareness, that provides the opportunity for him then to emphasize his identification with his brothers for purposes of present instruction so as to encourage brotherly kindness en route to the consummation. You see, so he's teaching here in the first century, so he highlights those people that then allows him to go from that to instruct them, no, I identify with them. They're going to say, why? Why is because I identify, so he gets to teach to encourage this kind of brotherly kindness en route to the consummation. Okay, do with that what you want. That's kind of a little detour. These things strike me sometimes, and I think maybe they'll strike maybe 1% of the people, so I give it to you anyway. All right, the next category I want to look at, how I've grouped these things, is the kingdom is good news for the needy. Okay, I want to look at a number of parables here. The kingdom, the first one we're going to look at is the two debtors. Now, the parable of the two debtors, it occurs only in Luke chapter 7, verses 41 through 43, but there's a good deal of background to that and what's going on, and just let me fill that in for you, then we'll look at the parable itself. Luke tells us that a Pharisee we learn in verse 40, whose name's Simon, he invited Jesus to a dinner with him at his house. So this Pharisee Simon has Jesus come for dinner. Now, we're not told the reason for the invitation. Nothing is said about that. But clearly, Simon was aware of Jesus' reputation as a prophet. You see that in 7:39. See, whatever reservations he may have had about that identification, that reputation, that claim, he was clearly aware of his reputation as a prophet. Maybe social custom dictated that a visiting religious teacher be included on the guest list. Maybe Simon was just curious. But we're not told, but here's this Pharisee Simon invites Jesus to a meal at his house. Now, the fact they're reclining at the meal, this indicates that it's a relatively formal occasion. Perhaps it was a banquet following a synagogue gathering. Reclining was the normal position at which special meals were eaten. See, it was that normal position for those kinds of meals. Each person, as you no doubt know, would lie on their left elbow, head toward this low table that had the food on it, and their bodies and legs angling away from the table, and they would eat from the table this way. You see, so this is what would take place in these special kinds of meals. Now, these kinds of meals, these special meals, they were semi-public. Now, that kind of blows our minds. But they were semi-public in that the door was left open, and uninvited guests could come in and sit by the wall and listen in. So this is the way this was conducted. This is how they lived, and that was the culture and the custom. Pharisees, of course, they're a sect or party within the Jewish religion that was noted for its piety and its concern for ritual purity. See, that's who the Pharisees are. They're very much that way. Paul, who's a former Pharisee, Paul described the Pharisees in Acts 26:5 as the strictest sect of the Jewish religion. And the name Pharisee, in all likelihood, it conveyed the notion of separated ones. You see, possibly meaning separated from ritual impurity. And Snodgrass, in his book Stories with Intent, he says the Pharisees had a concern for purity at meals that we can hardly appreciate. So they were very, very concerned with ritual purity and with purity at meals. Now, Pharisees, by the way, they invited Jesus to meals at other times. You see that in Luke 11:37, Luke 14:1. And they warned Jesus that Herod was wanting to kill him in Luke 13:31. So one need not read anything sinister into Simon's invitation of Jesus to come and eat. Now, indeed, whether in deference to others or whether he was speaking from his own perspective, Simon, in verse 40, he refers to Jesus as a teacher, which was a title of respect and a title of honor. Now, while Jesus was reclining at the table, you got the picture. Here it is. Place is open. People can come in. Jesus is reclining at the table. An uninvited guest approaches him from behind. And it's a woman who lived in that town, a woman Luke simply describes as a sinner. And she probably was a prostitute, but that's not certain. She approached Jesus with a flask of ointment or perfume. Perhaps she's intending to anoint his head with it. But when she got next to him, here's the table, here are the people coming out. She comes up and she's got this flask. Maybe she's going to anoint his head. That would be more customary. But as she gets so close to him, she just breaks down. She just breaks down into this uncontrollable sobbing and crying just from being close enough to Jesus. And as her tears rained down on his dirty feet, she let her hair down and she mopped his dirty feet with her hair, and then she lavished kisses on his feet and poured perfume on his feet. Now that's a scene. You see, that's a scene. Now since the woman brought the ointment with her to the banquet, it seems clear that she was intending to anoint Jesus with it, which means that he had already touched her life in some significant way. His preaching quite likely had been heard by Simon, by the guests, and by the woman. Now, for a woman to let her hair down in public, in that culture at that time, was considered a shameful and seductive act. You see, it had this idea of seduction to it. But it was considered shameful and seductive. But sometimes it was done for purposes of religious devotion and gratitude. Snodgrass says kissing someone's feet was the ultimate way to express honor, gratitude, and submission. But it was also a deep act of humility. Now, anointing somebody's feet instead of their head, anointing somebody's feet would be highly unusual. And doing so with expensive perfume or an expensive ointment, that would be an extravagant act. Snodgrass comments, he says, by letting her hair down, touching Jesus' feet, even with her hair, and anointing his feet with perfume, she contravened every social convention of the day. Were it not for her tears, the acts would border on the obscene. You see, when she's crying, you see something else is going on. This has nothing to do with seduction or any of that. There's some other emotion that is in play that is evident from her tears. But when Simon saw the sinful woman wiping her tears from Jesus' feet with her hair, kissing his feet and anointing his feet with expensive ointment, his reaction was he was indignant. You see, he was indignant. He thought, he said, look, in his mind, Jesus' tolerance of this behavior, it proved that Jesus was neither righteous nor a prophet. A prophet would know that the woman was a sinner and wouldn't allow himself to be defiled by her touching him, let alone by her touching him in such an over-the-top, extravagant way. A prophet would know who this was. And we'd be going, oh, you can't be defiling me. You can't be touching me like that. And this Pharisaic notion, you see, of sinners being defiling, it probably grew out of warnings in Scripture against associating with evildoers. See, there's roots for these things. For example, in Proverbs 1:15, 2:11-15, 4:14-19, there are warnings about this. And it's reflected in the Jewish writing, Ecclesiasticus, not Ecclesiastes. This is a non-canonical writing, Ecclesiasticus, written around 180 B.C. And this is that says in Ecclesiasticus 13:17, what fellowship has a wolf with a lamb? No more has a sinner with a godly man. And there's a rabbinic tractate, Mechilat Amalek, a 4th century compilation of material that may go back to the late 1st century, early 2nd century. So if it does, then we're at least getting close to the mindset, so it's relevant, I think. But this tractate says, in this connection, the sages said, let a man never associate with a wicked person, not even for the purpose of bringing him near to the Torah. Not even for purposes of bringing him near to the law. All right, so you can see how this stuff gets. So this is like, and here's Jesus, this woman is just all over him, kissing him, wiping his feet. And this guy, this Pharisee's going, man, this guy, if he was really a prophet, he'd know the score, know what's going on. Now, though Simon said these things to himself, right, meaning he's thinking them, Jesus answered what he was thinking by telling him a parable. So here you have Simon concluding, oh, Jesus can't be a prophet, and then Jesus responds to what he's thinking. I think that's interesting. Luke 7, 40-50. And Jesus answering said to him, so here's Simon thinking this stuff, and Jesus answering said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. And he answered, say it, teacher. A certain money lender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii, the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debt of both. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon answered, the one, I suppose, for whom he canceled the larger debt. And he, Jesus, said to him, you have judged rightly. That's the correct answer. Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, have been forgiven. That's where I modified the ESV in keeping with many other translations, and I'll say something about that in a second. It's a perfect tense, and I think here we need to draw that out, okay? He says, therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, have been forgiven, for she loved much. I'll say more about for she loved much. That is the evidence of her having been forgiven. You see, for she loved much, just like in the parable, you see? Then he says, but he who is forgiven little loves little. And he said to her, your sins are forgiven. It's another perfect. New American Standard says have been forgiven. But the way the perfect works, right, it's like your sins are in a state of having been forgiven. You see, the act of forgiveness was in the past, but the state continues in the present. It's like if I say I'm cut. You see, I'm presently cut, but the cut happened, what? In the past, but I'm in a state of being cut. All right, that's how the perfect functions commonly, okay? But here I think it's good to just leave it as are, because the focus is on her present. Okay, your sins are forgiven. Then those who were at table with him began to say among them, who's this? Who even forgives sins? And he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Okay, the point of the parable, which Simon confesses, is that the degree of love expressed to a forgiver, okay, the degree of love expressed to a forgiver is expected to be proportional to the extent of the debt forgiven. You see, that's the point. And Simon confesses that answer, and Jesus says that's correct. Jesus then applies that point, you see, to explain the woman's extravagant appreciation of him and Simon's lack of appreciation of him. Because here they're jumping on this woman, and Jesus is going to explain what's going on. What can possibly account for this extravagant show of gratitude and tremendous affection and love? And so he tells the parable, gets Simon to give him the answer, and he says, you got it right. Now, let's take that and let's look at the situation at hand. And so he then applies it, you see. He explains her extravagant appreciation of him and Simon's lack of that. Simon didn't go out of his way to do anything special for Jesus in terms of hospitality. He wasn't hostile to him. He was indifferent to him. You see, he was indifferent to him. He showed absolutely no appreciation of who Jesus is. Simon didn't give Jesus the common courtesy of supplying water for him to wash his feet. And he did none of the things above and beyond common courtesy that would honor a guest. He didn't kiss him as a greeting. He didn't anoint his head with oil. He just was indifferent to him. He's just another schlub here. You see, the woman's deep appreciation of Jesus was due to her recognition of the magnitude of her guilt before God. She knew the size of her debt that had been forgiven. I've got a parable for you. Big debt, little debt, both forgiven. Who loves more? One with big debt. She knew that a tremendous debt had been forgiven her. And because of that, she loved much, just like in the parable that you just confessed. You see, that's why. So she loved much for that reason. It was because of that. Therefore, she loved much. Joel Green, in his commentary on Luke, he says, when had she been forgiven? As in narratives more generally, so here we're confronted with a gap in the storyline, and we must assume some prior encounter, the effect of which was her forgiveness. This is hardly unusual for Luke, who occasionally introduces persons into the narrative who have already begun the journey of discipleship in some sense, though we're never told when or how. What we are told is that she had already been forgiven. So she's been forgiven, and she comes to the place to express her tremendous gratitude for Jesus. Was that a bell? Ooh. Okay, she comes to do that. That's why she's bringing the flask of ointment. And in keeping with the parable, you see her extravagant love was a result of her having been forgiven. You see, that's the whole point of the parable. Who will love him more? The one who's had the bigger debt canceled. You see, her extravagant appreciation, her love, was a result of her having been forgiven. It wasn't a cause of her being forgiven. And we sometimes look at it that way, and that's just missing the boat. It was a result of her having been forgiven. Here's what Daryl Bach says. The parable explains why the woman acted, and her actions testify to the presence of forgiveness which produced love. Because the woman was forgiven much, she loves much, just like the parable. You see, her love is demonstrated by her actions so that her great love reflects the presence of great forgiveness. The forgiveness is not a result of the acts, rather the acts... Oh, the screen went out. Rather the acts testify to love's presence and gratitude for the previous granting of forgiveness. Now if I get here, okay, you see in 47, this thing's flicking. In 47, see that phrase, for she loved much? In verse 47, that means that her great love is evidence of her prior forgiveness. Let me show you how Bach illustrates that, and I think it's pretty good. He says the statement, it is raining because, he's using that for four. That's why I put in or four, okay? The statement, it is raining because or for the windows are wet, does not mean that the water on the windows is the cause of the rain. Rather, the water on the windows evidences the presence of rain. You see, and that's what's going on here. You see, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven because she has the evidence flowing out of that forgiveness. For she loved much, which is the evidence, the indication that her many sins have been forgiven. And in fact, you see here, instead of for she loved much, there are many translations that try to make that clear because we stumble over that sometimes. So you have, for example, the New Revised Standard says, hence she has shown great love. The TNIV and the NIV 2001 say, as her great love has shown. New English Translation, thus she loved much. Christian Standard Bible, that's why she loved much. Okay, so that's the sense here. And I think that's important to see. Now, the fact she expressed her appreciation to Jesus for the great forgiveness she had received shows that she understood something of Jesus' divinity. She comes to Him. Right? She comes to Him to thank Him for the forgiveness. At the very least, it shows that she had some understanding of His unique relationship with God. And Jesus does nothing to discourage her in that regard and even confirms her understanding by telling Simon, the you in verse 47 is singular, He's speaking to Simon. He tells Simon that her sins have been forgiven. And there, as I say, it says that He said to her, 47, I tell you her many sins, which are many, have been forgiven. And I can just give you like that, it's translated that perfect tense, that aspect is brought out in the New American Standard, New Revised Standard, NIV, TNIV, New Jerusalem, Christian Standard, NIV 2011, okay? So this is an understood thing. And so He tells them that, and He's saying, I tell you. When He says, I tell you, her sins have been forgiven, that seems to connect Him to the forgiveness in a more direct way than simply announcing that forgiveness occurred. When He says, I tell you that the sins have been forgiven. He's connecting Himself to that forgiveness in a way, and that's in fact how the crowd understood it, right? In verse 49. Because they said, then those who were at the table said, began to say, who is this who even forgives sins? They got it. They understood the woman came to Him. Why? Because He was the point. He was the one responsible in some way for her forgiveness. And so He does nothing to discourage that. Now Jesus says to the woman, perhaps to reinforce or encourage her, or to repeat it, for the benefit of the other guests, He says in verse 48, that her sins are in a state of having been forgiven. As I said, it's again a present tense. New American Standard says, have been forgiven. But He says, your sins are forgiven, perfect. And I hope you understand that idea. Like when I say, I am cut, it means I'm in a state of being cut. The cut happened before, but I'm now presently in a state of something that happened to me in the past, right? It has ongoing consequences. And so that's how this is. When it says, your sins are forgiven, and I think it's right to take it as are there because that emphasizes the present state. She is in a state of having been forgiven. I hear that bell. Let me say another thing here, and then I'll shut up for today. Okay, Jesus is, of course, fully aware of the woman's sinful past, right? That's why He refers to her many sins having been forgiven. So He responds to another one of Simon's thoughts. He said, if this man were a prophet, he would know. Well, He knows. He knows. He speaks of her many sins. But her many sins have been forgiven. And that's why I grouped this in here, that the kingdom is good news for the needy. I'll have to pick up here, Lord willing, next week. But what I want you to see is that the kingdom is not for a religious elite. The kingdom is open to all people. I don't care how ugly your sin. I don't care how long you were trapped in it. I don't care how ashamed of it you are. The kingdom is open for all people. You see? Now that's good news. All right, thanks.